Hey everybody, this is Rust Bunch with Game Core. As you probably saw from the title of this video, I recently reached 400,000 subscribers. It actually happened last week. Now, it's totally amazing and really surreal to even have that happen, and I'm still kind of processing that whole number altogether. All the same, I'm not very good at celebrating accomplishments, and so I wanted to kind of take a moment and really just talk a little bit about this channel, and that's why when I made the celebration post last week talking about it, I also opened up for a bunch of questions. So I thought we could do a question and answer session. So that's what we're going to do here in this video. Now, I got like over 500 questions between Twitter and YouTube, and so I'm not going to be able to hit all of those, obviously, but I did round up most of them and then kind of put them in categories. And so there's going to be about 10 questions altogether that we're going to cover here in this video. I'm hoping that this will show a little bit of insight into the channel itself and maybe a few of the things that I don't really talk about when I'm making my typical videos. Anyway, without any further delay, let's go ahead and jump right in. So the number one question I got was mostly about like my background. How did I get into this stuff? What did I do before it and things like that? So let's talk a little bit about that. To start, I am from Washington State originally. It's the little state in the northwest part of the United States. And I lived there for like the first 20 years of my life. I then joined the Navy. It's a family thing. So my grandfather was in the Navy, my dad was, my brother was. And so it was just a way to kind of see the world. And so I became a linguist. And so I went to a language school in Monterey, California, learned the Russian language, spent a couple years doing that. And then I got stationed here in Hawaii as my first duty station. Within that first year, I met my wife, and so we hit it off. And I ended up extending here in Hawaii for quite some time. So I lived here for like 7 or 8 years in the beginning. And then we moved away to the mainland and lived all sorts of other places. And then eventually we got our way back. And so that was right before the pandemic. We finally got back to Hawaii and we've been there ever since. Now, my wife's from here, and so it's always been home for us basically ever since I kind of got into that family. And so I've always considered Hawaii to be home even since my 20s. And so it's been great. I love living here. It's a little bit different. Another question that I got a lot was just like, what is life like in Hawaii? A lot of people think it's going to be like going to the beach every day. And there are people who do that, you know, people who can surf and go to the beach and stuff. But your typical Hawaii living is not going to be like that. It's similar to like people living in LA and like, oh, you must go to Disneyland every day. That's not quite how it is. And so I love this place. The people here are amazing. The weather is always great. And the food is also really good too. And so I'm a really big fan of Hawaii. I don't know if we'll live here forever, but we're going to be living here for quite some time. We actually help take care of my wife's parents. And so that's one of the reasons why we'll be here for quite some time. I also like the idea of my kids going to school here because the people are very kind and they're learning just kind of a local way of life. And so I do want to instill that in them because I think it does make them better people. Okay, so that's a quick story about how I got to Hawaii and why I call it home. Now, another question I got a lot was about my military background. Now, like I mentioned, I was a translator, and so I translated for both Russian and then Indonesian, which I learned later on as well. The thing is, I was in for 22 years. I full-on retired from it. And as you rank up in the military, often you don't do the same job as you did in the lower ranks. And so I got to a point pretty early in my career, like within the first 10 years, where I was no longer really working with the language, but instead working with like policies and programs related to language. And so that's what I ended up doing with the majority of my time in the military was like leadership positions. I made a rank called Master Chief, which is the highest rank you can get in the enlisted side, so like an E9. And I made that pretty quickly in like the 15-year mark. And so I spent a lot of time doing policy stuff, leadership stuff, you know, like money, personnel stuff, just kind of boring things. But I found it really exciting to kind of help the entire cadre of military linguists kind of move in a certain direction. So a lot of developmental stuff. And I also spent some time teaching Russian. And so that's where a lot of my kind of teaching and guides come from here within the Retro Game Core channel is because I spent a long time both teaching the language, but then also developing curriculum for it. And so that's kind of always been part of me. I love doing that stuff. And so that's what's carried over here to Retro Game Core. So now that brings us to why I created this channel in the first place. And so it all goes back to the pandemic. And so as everything kind of went to hell in a handbasket, I was sent home from the Navy for a while, and there's a lot of reasons for it, but basically I was stuck at home for several months. And so I was trying to work remotely, which is not really something we do in my line of work. And so I had a lot of time on my hands, and I got to the point where I needed something new to do. I had already like made some music and I was like working on a novel, and I just needed something more. And so I ended up buying a retro handheld, and it was the RG350, which is like one of the first Ambrinic devices that they ever created, and it had a lot of issues. Like, it was one of those where first getting it started like took like a PhD in understanding how Linux worked and everything else. And I thought that the process could have been a lot simpler, but the thing was that a lot of the guides and tutorials were scattered all over the internet. And so I spent a bunch of time like making a Word document to kind of organize it for myself, and then I was like, I should put this on the internet for other people. And so I started a website and I called it Retro Game Core. I'm not really sure why I came up with that title. I wanted the word retro game in it, and core kind of fit for me because it was like a core, like from the sound of the word, but then also like a group of people, like the French word core, like Marine Corps. And so that kind of all came together. And so it was not like a long thought out process. This was like a 30 second thing. I made that, and then I made a quick logo, and within a day I had the website up and running. Now, the thing about it was that I didn't want to actually make YouTube videos. I wanted to just make written guides. And so that was one of the things I really liked doing, was writing. And I've been a cookbook author before. It's not another thing I mentioned, but yeah, I also wrote 3 cookbooks previously. And so that was part of it too, was like writing recipes, writing tutorials. It's all very similar. And so anyway, putting it all together, I decided to create Retro Game Core as a written guide like website. And then I found that I wanted to make some YouTube videos to really showcase what I was talking about, because there's some things you just can't write about, you have to show. And so I started like making visual accompaniments to my written tutorials, and I did that for a bit. And then it turned out that I was getting a lot of good reception from the videos. If you go back and look at them now, they're terrible. Like, the audio was terrible. I didn't know what I was saying. I'm still not really great at talking off the cuff like this, but all the same, like, it was a good starting spot. And so I was learning things, and that was really sparking the creativity in me as well. I was like, oh, it's kind of neat to start a new platform. I'd already done like photography when it comes to like food photography, and then obviously writing as well. This was a new medium. And so I kind of dove into the whole YouTube thing and did it for a while, and then it started picking up pretty quickly. And so other devices came out and I got those in the hand, and I was like, I'll make guides about them. And I'm like, well, if I've got the device, I might as well do a review as well. And so I started making reviews of them too. And those picked up even more. And I realized that there was people who wanted like those handheld review videos. And so I started working on that as well. And it just kind of all grew into what Retro Game Core is now. For the longest time, I wanted it to be like 90% guides and 10% reviews. And I think it's kind of the opposite now. A lot of that has to do with the fact that there's just so many devices out there that I do want to cover them. And the biggest thing for me is helping people to understand whether or not something is going to be a good fit for them. Because I would hate for somebody to buy something for $100, $200, $300, and then realize that it's not the perfect device for them. They wanted something else. And so I've always kind of tried to stick to that, to say, hey, if you're going to be buying something, this might be the best fit for you. It's just getting more and more complicated as more of these devices come out. All the same, when I find a device I really love, then I do want to make a guide for it as well. There are a lot of other channels making guides now, and I think a lot of those are doing a really good job. But all the same, I like doing the written guide as well as the video guide as well. So I kind of do a mix of both. Anyway, that's really just a long story to say how I started Retro Game Core and why we're here today. Now, the next question that was probably the most besides my background was specifically about my dream handheld. There were questions about whether or not there's an existing device that is like the one that I like to use all the time, or if there's one that I just kind of haven't seen yet, but I would like to see, like, what feature do I really want? This is a really hard question, and by the way, none of this stuff is scripted, so I haven't even thought about my answers. I'm just kind of speaking off the cuff. But I will say, when it comes to an existing handheld, that's complicated for a couple reasons. Number one is the fact that, you know, there's different platforms. So there's your handheld PCs, and I think it's been pretty obvious here on this channel that I think the Steam Deck is the best example of that. It is the most console-like of all those handheld PCs, which is a really important factor for me in the fact that it's just easy to pick up and play. And so that's been always really important for me. By the way, you can probably hear an ambulance in the background. This happens all the time when I'm recording, but usually I will just pause, then re-record and edit it out. We're just gonna keep rolling. Anyway, so when it comes to certain platforms, I have different needs. And so for a handheld PC, yeah, definitely a Steam Deck. When it comes to Android, I think that the Odin 2 is probably the best example there. And there are different reasons why this one is a game system that I would prefer over the Steam Deck. It's got a smaller size, it's got longer battery life. So there are some things that are nice about it, but I will say that Android is like not the platform for me. I really try to make it work and I try to do the best that I can to enjoy it. But when it comes down to it, I can never forget that there's a layer of software underneath and over my gaming experience. And so that one is never really fit for me. Instead, I really do like those kind of Linux platforms. And so the Steam Deck, I would argue, is also a Linux platform, very console friendly. But then also there's all those cheaper ones, you know, the emulation station driven ones. And that is really where my heart lies. You know, that's, you know, the RG351 was one of the first devices that I had on the channel, and that was also Linux based. I learned everything I knew about emulation station and all that background in those videos. And so I've always kind of had a soft spot in my heart for those, way more than Android. And so when it comes to those, they're still not a perfect one. I think what it comes down to is the user experience is pretty good once you get a hang of it, but the power is not there yet. And so, you know, you take a device like the RGB30, you know, this thing has that Linux firmware availability for it and multiple different operating systems, which is pretty awesome. Or you take like the Miu Mini Plus, also Linux based. Those are great, you know, but the thing is that they can't play GameCube and PS2 reliably. And that's kind of where it's at for me when it comes to retro gaming. Those were the systems that I played a lot of back in like 2003. I was going on a lot of deployments and whatnot, but when I was home, I would be playing GameCube or PS2 with my roommates, and we just had a lot of fun with that. And so I'm looking for a small emulation handheld that can play those. And right now we don't have any chipsets that are actually powerful enough to be able to play those Linux operating systems. There's a whole thing about drivers and whatnot, and I'm not gonna go into detail about that, but as you can imagine, it's just not there yet. And so I think in a couple of years, we probably will be there. And so that's kind of when I talk about like my prospective dream handheld, it's gonna be something like that. Something with a very simple Linux-based operating system, good battery life because it's gonna be ARM-based versus x86 with the handheld PCs. And then, yeah, that really nice user experience, something very simple and good enough to play PlayStation 2 and GameCube. Now, when it comes to the other stuff, you know, like what kind of D-pad or what size screen and whatnot, I don't know. I'm the kind of person who likes a lot of things, you know, like I find the joy in many things. And so I could see something like a square aspect ratio working very well, you know, high resolution like 720p or 1080p, but then also that really simple 480p resolution works really well too. And so I don't really have any opinions one way or another about the specs when it comes to like the D-pad positioning and stuff like that, as long as it works. The biggest thing for me is going to have something that is Linux-based, but then also is going to be able to play GameCube and PS2 reliably to the point where you're not having to go in and fiddle with settings. And that's, I think, where everyone wants to be. Okay, the next series of questions I got had to do with like the YouTube life. Like, what is it like to basically do this full time? What are some of the good parts? What are the bad parts? What are the things you're most proud of? And so on. And so let's talk a little bit about this. Now, I will say that doing YouTube as like a full-time profession is a little bit odd. For me in particular, it was something that felt a little bit isolating. So you can imagine in my previous job in the military here in Hawaii before I retired, I was leading a group of people who were in charge of the care and feeding for like 3,000 people. So I was just surrounded by thousands of people all the time. And, you know, making all these decisions that would affect others and just kind of weighing things and having all that interpersonal communication and whatnot. I really thrived in that kind of environment. I wouldn't say I'm an extrovert, but I do enjoy like just getting around people and, you know, talking through things and whatnot. So going from that to going to where I'm in this studio all the time is, it's a little bit odd. You know, you can imagine, you know, I see my wife and kids all the time. I do make a deliberate attempt to see my friends and whatnot, but it's a very different lifestyle. It's something that has to be very self-motivating. Like I have to really think about what I'm gonna do that day. And I'm not being driven by outside deadlines other than, you know, maybe some company wants me to make a video. Other than that, I don't really have anything else going on other than my own intrinsic like work ethic. And thankfully I really harnessed that in the military. And so it has been kind of seamless in that regard, but all the same, like, I do have to deliberately like make appointments to see my friends because otherwise I'm just gonna work here like 18 hours a day. And so that's been different. And it's one of the reasons why I actually went into YouTube. I like the idea of basically joining into a profession where there is no limit. Like there's no ceiling to what you can do within YouTube. I definitely had the opportunity to go into like a government job doing the things that I was doing, but on the civilian side within the military. And that was compelling in the sense that I was already good at it, right? And the pay was going to be something that was decent, and then also it was steady, right? So I liked that idea, but at the same time, I knew exactly what to expect in terms of like what pay grade it would be, what the promotion cycles would be, all that kind of stuff. And that was a big turnoff for me. I didn't like that whole promotion cycle in the military. It was just kind of an undue stress and competition that I don't think really needs to be there. And so I love the idea of being a YouTuber where The only thing that's stopping me is my own creativity. And I'd never been in a position where that was the driving force of my life. And I like that because I always considered myself to be a creative person. And so that was one of the reasons why I jumped into the YouTube side, was because I just wanted to see what it was going to be like. I told my wife, I said, give me 5 years to do this and we'll see, you know, in 5 years, I'll know whether or not it's a raging success or not. And, you know, I think after that, it might be time to actually do a real retirement instead of retiring out of the military, but an actual like, okay, now I am going to take it easy. And so that's always kind of been the goal. And we're 1 year into it at this point. And so that's kind of how it's been as far as being a YouTuber. Now, a couple other questions, I'm kind of looking at them as I'm looking at it. One of them is, what do I enjoy about the video making process? Well, the thing is that I'm not someone who I find myself to be super creative when it comes to things like B-roll or getting the perfect shot. For me, it's all about the story that I'm telling. What am I trying to communicate to others? And I think the visuals do go a long way when it comes to helping with that. And I have been trying to up my game when it comes to like my videography. But all the same, it's secondary to what I'm trying to convey when it comes to communication. So I don't mind when the camera just kind of rests on a device while I'm talking, and then I just say something that I find to be compelling and interesting. And so I always am going to focus on what I have to say. And so I like that part of the process. But the interesting thing here is that that's actually the last part of the process that I do. So what I do is, when I get a new device in my hands, I kind of treat it like a documentary. So I get this thing in and I unbox it and I'm videoing like all of that, right? Testing it out, seeing what works, what doesn't work, and I'm just like making notes as I go. And I will film for hours and hours and hours. I'll spend days on that. And I'm basically just compiling all the footage that I can. Afterwards, I go into my editing software, put that all in there, and then I edit it together to start to tell the story. Like, what are the things that stood out to me in the time that I spent with it? It's the same way that like a documentary filmmaker would be. Like, they would film a bunch of lions on the savannah for, you know, days and days on end. And then they would put that together later and create the story. And then some guy is going to come in and voice over that narrative. So I do that same thing. I make all my footage, I edit it together to create that story. Like, what is the experience like? And then I watch that back, and then I tell my own narrative during that part. It's a long process. I probably put 40 hours into every video. And as you can imagine, when I do 2 to 3 videos a week, that's a lot of work. And it definitely is. I'm doing a lot of long hours. But that's part of my process. And I love the moment where I take all that footage and I put it together and I basically create something that is a story, that it's something that I hadn't thought of before. But once I have all that together, I've now got like this definitive idea about the device based on my own experience and some of the thoughts I've had as I spent those days with it. And so that part right there where I'm putting it together to create the story is like that moment that sparks a lot of joy in me. That's my favorite part of the filmmaking process, because I'm taking something that is really just footage and then creating something out of that. And so I do enjoy that. The voiceover and stuff is really secondary. I do that like after the fact, after I've already kind of thought through like my entire storyline. Nothing scripted. I don't ever write out a script. I will sometimes do an outline to make sure I'm hitting the right things at the right time. But that's it. Everything else is just going to be off the cuff. That's why I will often repeat myself when I'm talking. It's because I don't notice it. I'm not writing it down and writing like this perfect prose. That would disrupt my process a lot, because then I have to read it and I don't think I can read very naturally as opposed to just speaking. And so that's why things are a little bit different when it comes to my videos, and why I get a lot of comments from people saying, hey, you said this word too much. And I'm like, yeah, I know. But at the end of the day, did you understand what I was saying? And that's the most important thing for me. Now, some other questions I had about the YouTube life was, one, am I getting burnt out? And no, not really. I take a break when I need to. Often when I make a big epic video, like, you know, my Steam Deck videos or whatever, you won't see another video for me for a few days. And that's because I'm taking a day to just kind of relax and maybe read comments and respond to them. And then I'll get back into it. Maybe I'll catch up on a movie or something like that. And then I'll jump back into it when I'm ready. And thankfully, you know, that work ethic kind of keeps me going. And so I don't think that I'm going to get burnt out anytime soon. I will say that I'm getting better at saying no to opportunities. When it comes down to it, there are so many handhelds and other things worth reviewing that I just can't hit them all. And it makes me feel sad sometimes when somebody asks, hey, you know, can you hit this thing up? You know, this thing's been out for a while. This other YouTuber did it. Why can't you do it? And it's like, well, I gotta just pick my battles, and sometimes, you know, something just doesn't rise to the point where I get to make a video about it. And it kind of sucks, because often I will pay my own money to buy that thing, I'll test it out and everything, and it just won't get to that point, you know? And so it's hard, you know, in that sense that I am getting to the point where it's not burnout or anything else like that, but I am having to choose like the things I can't do with the channel. And it got to the point where I had like a list of 500 videos I wanted to hit, and as I knew, I just couldn't hit them all. And so it's just one of those things where, yeah, you may not see the video from me, and I want to do it, but my process doesn't allow me to just go off the cuff, hit record, and talk about something. You know, I've got to really kind of dive into it, and that's part of the magic of making these videos. Okay, another question people ask is, like, what devices did you hate the most, and, like, what do you dread revisiting, things like that. To be honest, if something is not that great, often I won't cover it very much. Part of that is, like, you know, I like to do those videos where I'm warning people against a device, but the thing is that sometimes these devices will improve over time. So what I like to do instead is do a bit of a wait and see approach. So sometimes I'll get a device and, yeah, it won't really, like, strike me right then and there, but maybe someone else will really get into it and they'll make some sort of firmware or software update for it, or they'll figure out some sort of hardware hack for it, and all of a sudden it's much better. Those are the videos I like to make. I like to say, hey, now this device is really worth getting, and it's thanks to all the people that put the time in. You know, like the Miu Mini is a great example. I wasn't so hot on that device when it first came out. I preferred another device called the Amranic RG280V. Now, that one actually probably had worse hardware in many ways, but I liked the software better, and there were just some reasons why I liked that one. I made a whole video comparing the two. Well, then all of a sudden, Onion OS came out, and you know, that was just kind of an amazing reveal where all of a sudden, yeah, I did like it better. And so I made a video about that. And then I just kept making videos about the Miu Mini and the Miu Mini Plus, and how sometimes, you know, someone will make this mixture that's magical between software and hardware, and it's worth celebrating. And so that's why I like to make those videos like that. Same thing with like software suites like EmuDeck. I love the idea that the Steam Deck on its own is really powerful, but getting emulation up and running on it does take some work. And so I like the idea that EmuDeck just goes in there and kind of makes that marriage. And so I like covering things like that. It's pretty amazing. Now, I can't get to them all. You know, I often will get software developers to say, hey, here's my tool, can you check it out? Or I'll get people who'll send me like 3D printed things that improve the hardware on a device. And there's just not enough time in the day. And so those are one of those things where I kind of will tweet about it, but maybe I won't be able to devote 20, 30 hours to making a whole video about it as well. Okay, the last question I had when it came to YouTube was about like working with brands and whether or not I'm like a shill or selling out or whatever. These things are very prominent in the whole video game and tech world, something I didn't really notice or realize until I was really getting into it as far as making my own videos. Now, I've worked with brands before. For example, when I was a cookbook author, you know, I get a lot of these companies trying to send me products and me promoting them or whatever. I never really liked that part of things. You know, it's the whole like influencer idea. I'm not into that kind of stuff. Now, one of the things I learned is that, you know, YouTubers have to find this balance because ad revenue is often not enough. You know, you get a little bit of that revenue every time someone watches a video, but that requires you to get a ton of views. And so that will inspire people to make very clickbaity things. Thumbnails, titles, or just the topics of their videos, they're trying to hit those like really big milestones. That's not really a big deal for me. I get videos that just tank, and then I got videos that do really well, and I put the same amount of effort into each of them. It's really about the extended product, like what happens when I'm done with that video, am I proud of it? And so that's really what I'm trying to focus on. Now, as a result, you know, that ad revenue will go up and down and fluctuates, and so often it's not enough for me and my family to live on. Now, this is where a lot of YouTubers will go and get sponsorships, where they will make it like an ad, like within their video, or they'll be sponsored by a company and then they'll like push them for a little bit. I don't do any of that stuff. I actually have an about page on my website where I specifically say that, you know, I don't get paid for any of this stuff. I refuse payment. I don't like work with the companies as far as like what they want me to say. I don't do any of that kind of stuff either. And so I'll leave a link to that if you want to read more about it down below. The cool thing about it is that the larger I got as a YouTube platformer, the like easier it was to call my own shots. When I first started as a YouTuber, you know, a company would send me stuff and I'd like get it and like, this isn't like a huge good fit for my channel. I'm not really sure if I even want to make this video, but all the same, I'm going to make a video and I'll talk about the good and bad and do all that kind of stuff. But sometimes like my heart wasn't into it. That's really changed for me now. It's gotten to the point where I will tell a company, you can send me the thing and I'm not guaranteeing a review at all. I might do it if I'm into it, you know, but all the same, like I have to decide what I think my viewers want to watch. And that's 100% exactly who I want to see the content that I'm making. And so as a result, I often will not make the videos, you know, if somebody sends me something, or I'll maybe integrate it into a video or be like, hey, and by the way, here's this case that I used and I like it and this is why, or if I don't like something, I just kind of don't show it. And so I've really liked to have that ability to call the shots. You know, I've had big companies try to send me things and, you know, their terms or whatever were not agreeable to me. And so I said, no, don't worry about it. I'll just buy it myself. Or if I am going to accept it, they have to accept my terms. So I have to say, hey, I'm going to say whatever I want. I'm not going to sugarcoat these things. I'm not going to show you any of it ahead of time or any of that kind of stuff. Like, there's no feedback loop going on with these brands. It's literally send it to me. I'll try to find the merits of it, and I'll talk about that in my video. And so that's kind of how I work when it comes to these brands. I do affiliate links. So that's like the other way that I make money. Got the ad revenue, and that, you know, I always hope that I get good views, but I don't really care about that. And then the other part is going to be like the affiliate link. So that really is like, you know, an Amazon link or a link to the company or whatever. And so what'll happen is if I make a review and then you buy it using my link, then I'll get like a small percentage of it. And often it is very small, like 2 or 3% of the sale, but all the same, that can add up. Now there's a temptation there, and, you know, full honest truth, it makes you want to like make all the good videos, right? You only want to say this thing is the best and you should buy it, and by the way, use my link. And there's a weird dichotomy there. Number one, I don't ever want to get to that point where I am overselling something, because I think it will erode your credibility. And so I never try to like oversell something, but all the same, I do look for joy in these devices. And so if I find something I like, I'm going to tell people about it. And I'll also talk about the bad stuff as well. What I find joyous may not be the same for others. And so that's why I try to kind of balance all that stuff at once. And I get it that there is this thing where it's like, hey, here's my affiliate link, make sure you buy from me, and this thing is amazing. And I never want to get to that point, and I don't think it's ever something that I could consciously do. But all the same, I do make a point to give non-affiliate links when I'm sharing it on social media. So my YouTube community post, if there's like a sale going on, I'll share it, but I'll also put the non-affiliate link. Because if you don't want to support me, like, it's all good. Like, I'm here to provide a benefit for the community. I want to make sure that you're getting the best deal possible. And often I want you to get it at a better deal than what I paid for it. But all the same, you know, I get it. Like, you want to support, don't want to support, it's all up to you. I've got things like Patreon and all that as well, but I don't actually provide anything extra in those. That's really, if you just want to support me and give me a little bit of money for the work, that's great. But I'm not going to ever like put a guide behind Patreon and say, hey, here's the RGB30. It's wonderful. And if you want a guide for it, you know, sign up for my $3 a month or whatever. Like, it'll never be like that. It's literally just, hey, if you want to support me, it's great. We're all a big community, right? Put your money towards the device instead. Let me help you save some money on that. Use the non-affiliate link. All that's good. I think it's all going to wash out in the end. At the end of the day, what I'm trying really to do is just make that this whole retro experience is great for everybody. You know, when I first got started with it, you know, I just found this magical quality when I was playing Super Mario Bros. 2 on a handheld device. And I want to give that to everybody. And there's different ways to give that to others, and it gets pretty complicated. But all the same, I want to cover those things and simplify it as much as possible. Now, whether or not, you know, that makes me money or not, it's kind of inconsequential. I think that overall, if it gets to the point where this isn't making as much money as it is right now, you know, to the point where I can actually sustain my family, then yeah, I'll have to think of other ways of doing that. It doesn't mean I'm going to sell out and start, you know, shilling or whatever. It's really just going to be a matter of maybe I'll have to slow down my video content, get a part-time job, you know, things like that. And so at the end of the day, I guess the way I'm talking about this when it comes to Retro Game Core is that I don't intend on ever doing any of those shilling things or overselling a device or anything else like that. I'm a positive person, and so I do like to find the joy in everything. After all, I think that there are a lot of people who put a lot of work into these handheld devices, and that should be celebrated. And so that is part of like my whole thing, just being positive and bringing that into the world. Now, all the same, you know, it's fine if, you know, you want to call me a shill or whatever. I get all that kind of stuff. But all I can really say is that I will always be genuine about how I feel about something. And whether or not that aligns to the way you see the world as well, that's going to be up to you. And I respect that either way. Okay, this is going on really long, and so I don't want to make this too drawn out, but I do have a few more questions. Now, one of the others were about like my background in terms of gaming, like what was it like growing up and whatnot. So, you know, the NES came out when I was in kindergarten, and I don't think we got it that very first year, but maybe like the year after. I was still very young, and I was one of five kids right in the middle. And so, you know, we had a lot of us that were playing this, and I feel like we were the first that had the NES like on my block. And so we got it so early that I remember it didn't have Mario Brothers. It had Gyromite and Duck Hunt with it. And then we also got Rad Racer pretty early on. I remember playing that game a lot. And so we played those a lot, and then, you know, we would rent games and stuff like that. So the NES was like our console for many, many years. Now, years later, when the Super Nintendo came out, we couldn't afford it. It was way too expensive. But couple of years after that, the Sega Genesis got a lot cheaper, especially like the big one before they made the small one. And so we ended up getting that one. And so we played Sega Genesis for quite some time. And then also we got the Sega CD and 32X, but it was like on clearance way after. Like it was like when Toys R Us was starting to discontinue it, that's when we got it because it was super cheap. But either way, we had all those systems and that's what I grew up playing. A lot of console games, mostly like action games and fighting games and stuff like that. Now, I have another fond memory in that in my like early teens, I had a friend who was getting rid of a Commodore 64. He was like gonna throw it out or something. And I said, hey, I'll buy that off you. I'll pay you $20 for it. And so that was a lot of money back then. And I ended up getting this Commodore 64 and a bunch of floppy disks. And my experience with the Commodore 64 is probably very different than others. Like I didn't really know what I was doing. I didn't really have like an instruction manual. So I learned how to boot some games and things like that. And I also learned how to code on it. So I figured out how to like make my own text-based game. And I don't think it was really using like a game engine or anything. I was just literally like making a text file, but I could make it interact with the user. And so I had this game where it was like, it was Mortal Kombat, but a text-based version. If you remember, you know, the arcade version of Mortal Kombat came out in like 92 or so. And I was way into it. I thought it was super cool, but I didn't really have access to arcade machines very often. And so I was waiting for like the Sega Genesis version. It just took forever. It was all that controversy about the blood and everything. And so I wrote like a text-based version of the game. And it was so funny. It was like, you could pick your character and be like, okay, you're going to be Kano or Sonya or whatever. And what do you want to do next? You want to punch? You want to kick? You want to jump kick? And you had to type it out. And then based on whatever you responded, like I would come in and be like, okay, you missed or you hit or whatever, 25% damage. And I didn't realize I was kind of making a role-playing game. I was just kind of trying to make a fighting game. And I remember there were some neat tricks I had where if you did a fatality, you know, you had to type in a certain code to be able to do it and be like, oh, you ripped his head off or whatever. And I would make the text turn red and it was like the coolest thing. And so I have some fond memories about that. I have no idea whatever happened to that Commodore 64. I probably got rid of it at some point. But all the same, it was just kind of fun. And I think that my experience with that computer was very different than other people. But all the same, that was another fond like video game memory I had. Now, once the mid-90s came around, I didn't really play a lot of video games. Like, I never played anything in those later console generations. And so, you know, I got into, like, sports, and I was playing, like, music and, you know, things like that. And so there was just a big gap for me. And basically, I remember later on, once I had, like, joined the Navy and moved here and stuff, I got a GameCube and I got a PS2. The PS2 was mostly for, like, watching DVDs back in the day. But then also, you know, GameCube games were a lot of fun, too. So I did have those systems. I didn't play them too often. I was on deployment a lot, and so I didn't have a lot of time to play those systems. But all the same, I really enjoyed that part. I really didn't get into video games again until the Xbox 360 era, and that was basically because I had a lot of time on my hands, and so it was just a great time to play a lot of those games. And so things like, you know, Halo 3 and Bioshock and stuff, great experiences. Half-Life 2, like the orange box, that was amazing too. So that was really great, and then basically ever since then I've been a pretty casual console gamer, so I got like the other Xboxes and the PlayStations and stuff like that. But I usually would only play like the big tentpole games, you know, like so when the big AAA game would come out, I never really liked playing online and stuff like that, nothing competitively, but I liked playing through a story. And so, you know, like when the new Uncharted would come out, I'd play that, or like Mass Effect, things like that. So I really enjoyed that, and I did consider myself a gamer for a long time. A lot of that fell off because, you know, work commitments and things like that. And then that whole like 10-year period where I was like a cookbook author, that took up a lot of my time as well. And so I was very casual as a gamer until basically the pandemic when I got the retro machines, and then I was like, oh man, this is great, whole new world. And so that's kind of my background when it comes to gaming. You know, definitely some intense moments playing NES and Genesis, and then also like playing Super Nintendo over at friends' houses and stuff like that. And then a big gap until basically like Generation 6, which is PlayStation 2 and GameCube. And then I just kind of picked it up from there. Okay, another question I got was about the studio itself, you know, and just kind of how this whole workflow works. And so I mentioned it before, but like my house is separate from the studio itself. And, you know, in the beginning, I was just making all my videos at the house, just on my desk, which is where that green mat comes from. Basically, it was just the easiest way to cover up my desk and to kind of make a surface. And so I was using that for a long time, just with my phone pointing down and then taking those videos. And I still actually do it the same way. I've got that green mat still at the house, but I have built another room here at the studio, which has the same green mat, same desk, and same setup. So I can film at both locations, depending on if I need to squeeze something in. And so you may see a little bit of inconsistencies when it comes to those videos with a top-down green footage. Maybe the zoom is a little bit different or whatever, and that's because I'm kind of trying to put it all together but keeping something pretty standardized. You know, it's funny, when I first got started, I asked people later on, I was like, hey, should I get rid of the green mat and experiment with other stuff? And a lot of people, like, overwhelmingly said, no, keep the green. It's like your iconic kind of look. And so I've kept it over these years. I have changed the way I film, so I'm, like, doing better when it comes to, like, the white balance and shutter speed and things like that. I have been taking the time to make the videos look better. But all the same, I think that the green standard format is still going to be there to stay. Now for the rest of the studio, I have like this area right here where I record from, and I've got my workstation over on this side, and that's where you'll see like when I'm working on a monitor and like plugging in a mini PC. That's what I'm doing, and that's just right here in the room. I did a whole studio tour about a year ago when I first got everything set up, and nothing has really changed since then, other than that extra room where I put in that extra desk. And I am working on another set piece, which will be a standing desk, which will be like a workbench. And so I'll film like talking while working on something at the same time. I never really do that. I'm usually filming myself working on something and then talking about it later, or I'm just talking to the camera. So I want to mix those two things together, and I'll probably do like a multi-cam setup so you can see the top down and me at the same time, and then I'll like splice it together. So that is in the works for the studio here. I did get the desk the other day, but I still got to figure out the lighting and the background and stuff like that. Now, another question I get is like, how do you stay organized? You've got all these devices and whatnot. And I will tell you that right now, it looks very clean right here. Everything else is chaos. I don't even want to show it to you. And so, you can imagine that I'm working on like 5 different videos at once. And so I just make like little movements and get further along in each of them as the days progress. And then I get to the point where I'm like, okay, this one's now ready. I'll finish this one and then I'll keep moving. And so, as you can imagine, it's just kind of chaos with all these things kind of laying around. About once a month or so, I'll get fed up with it and I'll just take the day off and I'll just clean everything, put everything in its right place and whatnot. And so I do that. And one of the ways that I help with that is that I have these organizing things, and they're these bamboo dish racks. And I'll show footage right here so you can see them. And basically I can stack up a bunch of handhelds on this. And we get these from like our local dollar store. And so it's very cheap, but an easy way to organize my stuff. I put these all on a shelf, and so then I can access all my handhelds. Now the thing is, it's probably not the best when it comes to like charging and stuff like that, but because I'm accessing these all the time for different comparisons and whatnot, I am constantly charging devices. Like, it's just one of those things that I do. Now, when I get too many of these things, what I do is a charity auction. So I have a little eBay store, and what I will do is I'll put a bunch of these used units up there, and then I will auction them off with like no minimum bid, and then 50% or more will go to charity depending on what's going on. And so that's actually a lot harder than it looks. There's a lot of time spent like taking the pictures, writing all the write-ups, and then managing the shipping and stuff. My wife helps out with a lot of that stuff, but all the same, it's not like she can write about the RGB30 and be like, oh yeah, this thing's got the RK3566 or whatever. And if she Googles it, it's like, there's not good information out there, right? If you go to the Pow Kitty website, it's like Greek, you know? And so I end up having to do a lot of that writing as well. And so it kind of waits, you know, for me to get the time to be able to put that stuff up for charity auction as well. So, you know, in the end, you know, I had this big grand idea of being able to do this weekly, where I would have just new things every week. But with my current flow of video production and stuff like that, and I've got no help, you know, I'm editing and all that stuff myself, I just haven't really got to the point where I can be consistent about it. So it'll be one of those things where, you know, I'll throw 10 up at once and then we'll do 10 a few months later and stuff like that. Either way, that's one of the reasons like that I try to keep things clean, is by getting rid of that stuff. And I also want to give back to the community. Now, a lot of these things I pay for myself, so I do want to get a little bit of that money back, but just because I'm like, you know, putting it away to these other things. But sometimes they're reviewing it and I don't feel good taking all that money either. And so I try to do the whole charity thing, and then whatever's left over, it all goes to my wife and she kind of puts in an account for funny money or whatever. Okay, and so I got two more before we start wrapping up. One is, like, a lot of people asked me about, like, what are the most negative or outrageous comments you've seen on the channel? And, you know, I kind of preface this by saying that I do read every comment that I can. There are some that I will miss here and there, but all the same, every few hours, I do try to go and read through all of them and respond as quickly as I can. I can't get to all of them. It gets to the point where I have to decide, do I respond to these comments or do I make a video? And I always have to choose to make a video just because I want to help as many people as possible. So if I didn't ever answer one of your comments, I apologize for it, but I just can't get to all of them. And I do read all of them and I appreciate them. Now, there are negative ones on there, and you can always tell the negative ones because a lot of times it'll be one of two sides. One will be people who are just like deep in the retro game core mythos, right? And they are just like, Russ, you said this one thing, but now you're saying a different thing or whatever. And, you know, people evolve, things are different or whatever. And so I can't be consistent all the time. I think I've made close to like almost 600 videos at this point. I try to remember everything I've said and how I feel about it. But all the same, you know, when I talk about like the RGB 30, I'm gonna talk about my experience with it right now. And maybe in the very beginning, I didn't like the D-pad as much as I do now, or I got used to it. And so this is kind of the evolving framework of having a channel. And so I get these people who will be like, hey, you know, you need to be more consistent, or your testing methodology is not perfect. I get all that stuff and I try to do my best, and I'm always trying to get better. So I always appreciate those comments. It does make me kind of reassess myself, and I love doing that. Now, the other ones are going to be like the flyby comments. And that's going to be people who are just, you know, they didn't watch the whole video, or maybe they don't really understand what Retro Game Core is all about or whatever. No fault of their own, right? I got no issues about that. But they'll leave something kind of hurtful, maybe on purpose, maybe not, or whatever. I get it. It's all fine. You know, there's that whole like anonymity buffer there. And so people don't realize that maybe a real human is reading that afterwards. But yeah, for the most part, I will read all of those comments. Now, thankfully, you know, after 22 years in the military, especially, you know, being a Master Chief for 7 of those years, I'm very used to having thick skin when it comes to that stuff. It's all good. You know, I take that stuff to heart, but I try not to let it affect me. So when it comes to specific negative comments, I can't really tell you any that I remember. None really keep me up at night. But one I always see all the time is people saying that I sound like Jesse Eisenberg. And I don't get that. You know, I've watched movies with him in it, and sure, whatever, you know. I think it's because he has a kind of clipped way of speaking, and I do have that as well. In fact, I have a weird accent. I don't know if anyone's noticed, but like, you know, I'm from Washington State, which doesn't really have an accent at all. It's just kind of your stereotypical West Coast, like American accent. But then also on my father's side, they're all from Minnesota. And I didn't learn this until later on in life. And so they all transplanted from Minnesota after World War II. And so everyone has this like Minnesotan accent. And I grew up hearing it, didn't understand that it was different. And I do still have like an upper Midwest accent. And it's funny because I've never lived in Minnesota ever before. I only picked up on it when I went to school in Wisconsin for like this Indonesian thing years ago, like 2005. And I remember being surrounded by these people, and I'm like, man, they all sound like family. Like, it sounds great. And it was only later that I learned that it was because my dad's side of the family is from Minnesota and they have that accent. So I do have this weird accent where it's like a half upper Midwestern one, even though I've never been there, you know, living or anything. The other part of it is that I've lived in Hawaii for off and on, you know, like 20 years at this point. And so I do pick up on some of the cues here. Now, there's a whole like Hawaiian pidgin like language and accent and dialect and stuff. I'm not going to go into detail about that, but my wife does speak that way. And I don't. I didn't grow up speaking in that way, so it's not natural to me. So I try not to like embellish and do any of that kind of local kind of stuff. Now, at the same time, I can't help but pick up on some things. So, for example, in Hawaii, everybody enunciates every syllable. So if you take the word like button, right, like the a button on your jacket or whatever. Now, initially, my reaction is just to say button, where you swallow those two T's in the middle, right? But my wife will say button every single time, right? Like, touch that button, right? And so I'm like in the middle of that, where I pick up on that sometimes and I don't in others. It's just really weird. There's also some strange, like, you know, Japanese and Chinese influence here as well. And so certain words are pronounced different here. So for example, karaoke is like a joke here. Like, no one says karaoke, they say karaoke, right? And so stuff like that, I try not to put into my videos, but sometimes it'll slip in. And so there's just these weird kind of regional things that have happened for me, just from like living all over and kind of picking up on those things as being a linguist. So I get it, people making fun of my voice or whatever, it's all good. And like I mentioned before, you know, I repeat myself sometimes too, because I'm all doing this off the cuff. I'm not writing a script. And so I get those comments as well. Like, there's one video in particular, like a Steam Deck emulation video, where I guess I said across the board a lot. And so if you look at that video, there's like 20 comments where people just wrote across the board like multiple times. And I get it. You know, those are mistakes that happen as part of being a human being, but I just find it funny more than anything. So any of those negative comments, it's all good, you know, and Yeah, I think that's really about it, all I have to say about that. Okay, so the last question here, and I didn't get a lot of these, but I got a few, and that was, what is my favorite snack and drink? You know, I say that a lot in my videos. If I know ahead of time it's going to be a long one, then I will say, grab a snack and drink and let's get started or whatever. And it's weird because the way I record, right, when I'm recording the intro, I still don't know how long the video is actually going to be because I still have to record all the voiceover and then I have to edit it down. And so it could be an hour long video. It could be 20 minutes. I don't really know yet until I've like said my piece. And so I just have to guess whether or not it's going to be a long one. And so sometimes people will be like, you didn't say to get a snack and drink, even though this is an older or a longer video. And I'm like, I didn't know at the time and I thought it was going to be a short one. And so it's always a guessing game for me. It's kind of funny. Now, as far as my own snack and drink, it's interesting. If you look at my cookbook stuff, which I'll leave a link down below if you are interested in checking out like my old food blog and stuff. It was a gluten-free blog, and I'm not going to get into detail, but basically I had a lot of health issues back in the day, and I fixed a lot of them by cleaning up my eating lifestyle, basically. And so I always, like, that's what started me making the food blog and then like all the cookbooks and stuff like that. And so I don't actually really snack that much at all. I just eat like my three square meals. And so I don't know. I don't really grab a snack and drink ever. But I do like drinking like kombucha. I like the fizziness of it and it's a little bit tart and stuff like that. So if I am going to have a drink, it's not water. It'll usually be that. But yeah, I'm not a snack and drink kind of guy, which is kind of funny. My favorite chip of all time, ironically, are Funyuns. And it's funny because I don't like onions. Like my username for a lot of things, as probably people have noticed, is onions are gross. Like that's the username I've used for a lot of things. And so it's just kind of ironic that Funyuns are my favorite chip of all time. And I don't know why that is. You know, maybe it's just the powder in them or whatever. It doesn't taste like real onions. And so it's great. Anyway, this is going on really long. I'm hoping to edit this down a little bit. I'll cut out some of the dead air just to make this a little bit faster as we go along. But again, I have no idea how long this video is going to be because I haven't edited it yet. So I'm hoping it'll be about 35 minutes, but we'll see how it goes. Either way, I appreciate you watching this video. I hope you learned a few things about me. It's a little bit awkward to do this where I'm like talking about myself so long, but all the same, I hope you found it insightful. At the end of the day, I really enjoy what I'm doing here with Retro Game Core. It's not something that I would ever have predicted as being like part of my lifestyle. I always hoped to become a novelist. That was the thing I always dreamed of doing, was just kind of sitting back in like, you know, my like little sweater jacket or whatever and typing on a typewriter or whatever. That never really came to be, although I'm still plugging away in a novel. That's a different tale for a different time. But all the same, I'm really appreciative of having this YouTube platform and just the ability to communicate with others and connect, you know. At the end of the day, this is probably the best place for me to be in terms of just having a YouTube space. There's a lot of things I could talk about. I could make a cooking show or whatever, talk about history. I love history. But retro gaming is really a great place for me because at the end of the day, all we're trying to do is play our favorite systems and our favorite games and restore some of those childhood memories. And I love being a part of that for other people. And honestly, I get that myself when I'm playing something and I get that little sparked moment of just, you know, playing whatever favorite Nintendo game that I've forgotten about. Playing it again is amazing. And so even if I had 4 subscribers or 400,000, I think I would still really enjoy those moments. And it's just a real big bonus that I have all these people here helping me along the way. And so I really appreciate your viewership and it means a lot to me. And I don't want to get too sappy here, but it's been great. And I don't plan on going anywhere anytime soon. And I don't think, you know, I'm not in a rush to get to 500,000 or whatever. But if it happens, maybe we'll do something else at the 500,000 mark. And so let me know in the comments down below, you know, what specifically you liked about this video, you know, in terms of insights, whatever. And then what would you like for me to do at the next milestone, 450 or 500 or whatever? And that could be, you know, 6 months, a year, 2 years from now. But either way, let me know in the comments down below. I really appreciate that. And so I guess that's it. And thanks for watching. And as always, be sure to like and subscribe if you found this helpful. And we will see you next time. Happy gaming.